You are watching Redicon.
We'll talk about some meniscal variants. Hopefully, if you know what they are, then that can result in fewer false positive reports. So oblique meniscal ligament, it runs between the posterior horn of lateral meniscus to anterior horn of medial meniscus. And it's it can be seen on axial sequence here, pointed by the arrowheads, or on sagittal sequence in the midline as a low signal intensity structure. Another meniscal variant is a ring meniscus, where you get central triangular low signal intensity structure, which may mimic a bucket handle tear. However, the difference is that the original volume of the meniscus remains, and it has a sharp contours with no blunting or truncation, and there's no volume loss of the main part of the body or posterior horn or anterior horn of the meniscus. That would indicate that this low signal intensity small area in the midline or close to the tibial spines is just a variant called ring meniscus, but the incidence is very low, probably less than 0.5%. Another meniscal variant is meniscal fluence, which there's a hypothesis that this is a result of a previous trauma. This is not a tear, and no intervention is required as long as you know what it looks like. So what you get is a waviness of usually the inner free margin of the meniscal body, but there is as long as you know what it is, and if you can describe it and just label it as meniscal fluence, and then in conclusion you can say there is no tear. So it's an important variant to recognize and to be able to dismiss it. Couple of other cases of meniscal tear where things can be missed by a radiologist. So meniscal flaps or flipped meniscal fragments can lie close to the meniscal roots. So here in this case, you can see that there's a rounded area or low signal intensity close to the posterior root attachment of the medial meniscus. It shouldn't be there. There shouldn't be anything between the cruciate ligaments and the femoral condyles in this area, because the meniscal root is onto the tibia, so this is pointing more towards the femoral condyle, so a suspicion should be raised about a meniscal flap in this region. In this second case on your right, you can see there is this tongue-like structure protruding posterior and inferior to the posterior horn of lateral meniscus, and you can see there's a bit of volume loss and blunting of the posterior horn of lateral meniscus. So you know that there has been a damage or tear to the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus with meniscal flap displaced posterior inferiorly. Fat pad impingement, there are a couple of them which are more common. Quadriceps fat pad, so normal quadriceps fat pad is of same signal intensity as rest of the fat around the knee joint, and it's not as thick, but in fat pad impingement cases, what you get is quadriceps fat pad thickening and edema and signal change. That would suggest quadriceps fat pad impingement, and it may well be the cause of patient's symptoms, that is anterior knee pain. Another cause of anterior knee pain might be supralateral Hofer's fat pad impingement, which is also known as patellar tendon lateral femoral condyle impingement, where you get edema, reaction, and thickening in the supralateral corner of the Hofer's fat pad, as demonstrated here by the arrowhead. That would suggest supralateral Hofer's fat pad impingements. You can also see there's mild edema in the inferior pole of the patella, which may well be mechanical or stress-induced. Another finding which try not to confuse it with the tear is a peripheral vascularity or signal change. So you see this linear intermediate signal intensity on these two images here. It doesn't cross the articular surface and is quite smooth. It may reach out onto the peripheral capsular surface or attachment of the meniscus, but it's not reaching the articular surface. So on the basis of MR characteristics, it's not diagnostic of a tear. You may see that in younger people, in teenagers, so I tend to label it as a peripheral vascularity and dismiss it. In older population, it may be more rounded with a bit of thickening of the meniscus, but the signal doesn't reach the articular surface, so it can be mucoid degeneration. Discoid meniscus, where the meniscus is quite thick and abnormal shape, and it almost covers the whole width of the tibial condyle. Lateral meniscus is most commonly involved, and they tend to go early under early degeneration and can have tears due to altered biomechanics and abnormal stress on these menisci. So what you get is, if the signal change is intrasubstance, then just label it as a myxoid degeneration. If there's a blunting, truncation, or the signal reaches the articular surface, then describe it as a tear using the same nomenclature as you would use it for a normal menisci. Thank you so much.
You can subscribe to our YouTube channel and click on the notification bell for new courses. For more modules and radiology CMEs, please visit www.radicon.org.